Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail, when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail. By the living word of God I shall prevail, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Let's sing that last together. Standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
All right, good singing, and again, good to see everybody here tonight. Looking forward to a good service together. Let's start with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer. We thank you for another Wednesday night that you've given to us. And Lord, we're thankful for each one that's made their way here to the service this evening. And Lord, we thank you for the wonderful promises that we have to stand upon. And thank you that all the promises are yea in you. And Lord, we love you tonight. We're thankful for the privilege to gather together and to be able to sing the songs of God and fellowship one with another, and then open up your word and study it together here this evening. Pray your blessing upon the service. Make it exactly what you would like it to be this evening. Use it in our hearts and lives, please. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Number 78, please. 78, sing the wondrous love of Jesus. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. 78, on that first together. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and
coming to read the missionary letter tonight. It's from Don Sturts and his wife, who celebrated their 42nd anniversary of surrendering to serve God. They began Couriers for Christ, and he's going to read about that, and they're just rejoicing over 42 years of seeing God provide for them and the ministry there of getting the gospel into, especially the Eastern European bloc countries. And you're going to enjoy this tonight. Brother Neil.
As the pastor said, this is from Don and Laura Sturtz. Reverend Donald Sturtz is the founder and director of Couriers for Christ. Praise ye the Lord, praise ye the Lord, O my soul. While I will sing praises unto my God, while I have any being, Psalms 146, 1 and 2. 42 years ago, Laura and I put down our knees beside our bed and surrendered our lives to whatever the Lord would have us do. The following Wednesday night, during a prayer meeting, we made our decision public. After that proclamation, we never dreamed how quickly our Lord would take us up to on our new surrender. Just a few weeks later, during a missions conference at Southside Baptist Church, now Wildwood Baptist Church, the Lord revealed to us that he wanted us involved in Eastern Europe. A few months later, in January of 1975, we began on a part-time basis working with an Iron Curtain ministry. 4 years later, the Lord led us to establish the Baptist Couriers for Christ as a local church ministry, again, out of the Wildwood Baptist Church. The Lord is nigh unto all of them that call upon him. To all that call upon him in truth, he will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. He will also hear their cry and will save them. Psalms 145, 18 and 19. Over the years, we have experienced our precious Lord's protection, knowing that he was nigh unto us as we would call upon him, especially during the Cold War era. As our fledgling ministry was secretly taking the word of God into Eastern Europe, we always had a desire to someday take tens of thousands of scriptures into those countries. We never dreamed that the Lord would do by opening up Eastern Europe and Russia in 1990. He certainly fulfilled our desire. Since 1990, they've had 82 containers containing scriptures in 16 different languages and have gone to over 30 countries. This includes 20 million John and Romans, 370,000 whole Bibles, 1.5 million New Testaments, and tens of millions of gospel tracts, plus hymn books and Bible study literature. Praise ye the Lord, for it is good to sing praises unto our God, for it is pleasant and praise is comely. Psalms 147, 1. We want to express our deepest heartfelt gratitude to all of you who have prayed for us over these years, as well as financially supporting us and our ministry of reaching into Eastern Europe and the Russian Federation. Any fruit that Couriers has gathered over the years will be added to your account. So that with all of our heart, we say thank you.
Amen. That's great. That's amazing. That's what's exciting for them is you're not going to know. You don't know the full extent of what God did with all that until you get to heaven. So just sow the word and sow the seed and you see the results later on. That's exciting. Well, get out your prayer guide, and while you're doing that, I want to welcome Tiffany and Carmen, I believe it is. They're visiting with us back here. They are radio listeners, and decided to come check it out. And Tiffany was Bunce, B-U-N-C-E, and she rode a church bus to Bible Baptist Church 28 years ago, and this is where she was saved and baptized. Is that right? And how about that? And that's amazing. Some of you old timers of you go through your files there in your brain and see if you can remember that family at all. There were four of you in your family, is that right, that all rode the bus and all got baptized here. Praise the Lord. That's great. Bunce, B-U-N-C-E. That's great. Good to have you tonight. Great. Good to have you back home. Amen. All right. Take your prayer guide now. We'll look at the back of that. And coming events, of course, tomorrow night, the RU Inside down at the prison, CRC Prison. Friday night, Reformers Unanimous right here at 7 o'clock at the church. And then, of course, Saturday morning out at London. And then Saturday morning for the soul winning and bus visitation at 10. Reminder, too, Brother Bowman's conference this Saturday, the Not For Sale conference at Heritage Free Will Baptist Church in That's 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. And I think that's a, you know, come for as much as you want or as little as you want, whatever you'd like. You're welcome to drop in on that. We'll be over there for that. They have a round table that I volunteered Bob Reed for from 10 to noon. Then I'm speaking two different of their breakout sessions during that time. So pray for a good time that day and that the Lord will speak to hearts. And that'll be a profitable conference for Brother Bowman and his ministry, all right? And then, of course, 1 week from tomorrow starts the Missions Conference, and it's coming up quick. We're excited about it. Thank you for getting the gifts in, and ladies are taking those in. And don't forget any candy you can bring in for the fair to pass out along the fair route. I saw several bags of that tonight, and remember that if you can to keep that coming in. And then Saturday night is the international dinner during the conference, of course, at 5 p.m. I think there's will be a sign-up sheet downstairs for that, so you can begin to sign up and for what you're bringing that night. That's always a wonderful time as well. And, of course, then we come in here after the service and or after the meal, and we have a service, and they receive their gifts on Saturday evening. All right. Then on the inside, we the praise report for the RU Inside Ministries, both at CRC and at London, with some new men. And, of course, men being saved at both places, and good things are happening there with the RU Ministries. Continue to pray for the different church requests and church ministries. Continue to pray for these on our health list, and particularly remember Paula Ross. She's at Mount Carmel West in room 719, and so please keep her in your prayers if you would, and for her health. And also Vicki Vaughn. Vicki is the one who was healed of the leukemia, but she's struggling right now with the, they had done a bone marrow transplant, and she is rejecting that bone marrow. And really, really struggling. And they're trying to work with her. She's still at OSU Hospital. And so sometimes a good day, and other days it's really, really rough. So keep Vicki in your prayers if you would. All right. And then praying for the ones in authority, and of course praying for our military, and then praying for these who are battling cancer, and then these on the salvation list, and praying for the Lord to bring them to a saving knowledge of Christ. And then the unreached people groups, again, another list of these who need to hear about Jesus Christ. And then our missionaries, and tonight highlighted by the Sturts and Baptist Couriers for Christ, and 42 years of faithfully getting the word of God to people. And that's a real blessing to have. Well, Brother Yoder, I'd like you to come if you would. It's always good when the Yoders are here with us in the service. And I'd like Brother Dave to lead us in our prayer this evening. And so let's bow together, and you pray along with him as he leads us audibly. We'll pray along with him silently, all right?
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we do come before your throne this evening with very thankful hearts. First of all, thanking you that we can call you our Father. We thank you for Jesus Christ and his shed blood on Calvary that makes all this possible. But Lord, you know we're a needy people, and that's why we're coming before you this morning, or this evening, not just to praise your name, but to tell you we need help in different areas. We thank you for this good testimony of the Sturts family that's been on the field for 42 years. And Lord, all the different literature from your word to gospel tracts that have been given out, I pray, Lord, that you would continue to use them for many years to come and to continue to work in the hands of the people that have received these things from you. We thank you for our church and the amount of missionaries that we've been able to support. But, Lord, we look forward to this missions conference, and we'd ask that you'd speak to our hearts. Be preparing our hearts now for the missionaries that are coming in. Lord, we want to be a blessing to them, but we also want to hear from heaven. So I thank you, Lord, that you've allowed us to be in this position here at this church that loves doing your work in this type of way. We would pray for the unreached people groups that do not have a copy of the Word of God or do not have missionaries in those areas. I pray that they would be reached before it's eternally too late, and we hold them up to you in prayer tonight. We thank you, Lord, for again for the great salvation that you've given us, but you told us in 1 John chapter 2, verse 2, that it was not for ours alone. So we pray for these friends and families that still need to be saved. And Lord, I know you're not slack concerning your promises. And so we'd ask, Lord, that you would please use one of us or someone that has knows the truth from the gospel, that these people would be saved before it's eternally too late. We thank you for allowing us to bring those that are sick before you. We thank you for the good news with Vicki Vaughn and how you've been working there. But Lord, it seems as though she's having some rejection now of the bone marrow. And Lord, I don't understand all those things and how that works, but you do. And I just pray that once again that you would show your mighty power on her behalf for the glory of God. And I'd ask that you would help her to be patient and to ease her pain during this time. We pray also for Paula Ross, that you would help her in her condition there. And we thank you for the way that you're so very near to us in time of need. And we thank you for bringing Miss Diane back to us here at the church and answering many prayers that we've had concerning Miss Stilton. And I pray now that you would continue to work with her body and help her, strengthen her. I pray for our military that's fighting on our behalf right now to keep us free, and we would ask that you'd protect these young men and women. And Lord, we especially want to uphold those that are from our church. And please bless their families as well. Lord, I would ask that you'd be with our pastor tonight as he brings us the Word of God, and I pray that you would use him. We thank you, Lord, for the good testimony that he has here in Grove City, and even those that I've talked to on the phone today that have known him for many, many years, and just the way that you've protected him, and we'd ask that you'd continue to do so. We pray that you'd be with Bob Reed as he assists our pastor in holding up his hands so that we can get the job done here in Grove City. We pray for our authorities that we have in our land. Lord, at times we're often discouraged and very upset by the decisions that are made. And so we'd ask, Lord, that you would please draw them back to you, and their decisions would be based on authority from the Bible. And Lord, that would be something only you could do. But again, we're bringing these prayer requests knowing that they're not landing on deaf ears, or they're not being stopped from the roof of this building, but you actually hear and care about us. We thank you, Lord, for loving us in a special way that you do. And Lord, once again, we would bring these requests concerning the missions conference, each and every one of these families that will be coming in. And Lord, I pray that we would be a blessing to them in just an incredible way, where they would be thankful that they are part of our church. Lord, we want to tell you that we love you. We thank you for being so kind to us. Lord, we don't deserve anything but to be thrown into hell, and yet you've saved us, you care about us, you love us, you want a relationship with us. And so we want to just tell you tonight that we love you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Number 294. 294, my faith has found a resting place, not in device nor creed. Let's all stand together as we sing 294 on that first together.
My faith has found a resting place, not in device nor creed. I trust the ever-living one, his wounds for me shall bleed. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me.
On that third,
my heart is leaning on the word, the written word of God. salvation by my Savior's name, salvation through his blood. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me.
Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together.
Enough for me that Jesus saves. This ends my fear and doubt. A sinful soul, I come to him. He'll never cast me out. I need no other argument. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me.
My great physician heals the sick, the lost he came to save. Let's sing that last together.
My great physician heals the sick, the lost he came to save. For me his precious blood he shed, for me his life he gave. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me.
All right, be seated if you will. Ushers will come and we'll get our offering tonight. It's the first Wednesday night of the month, and this is an offering for Brother Yoder and his travels. Lord willing, he'll be heading to India, I think, in February, and be holding a week of meetings or so there with the church, and prior to hopefully attending the Bible conference there with Worldview Ministries at the South India Baptist Bible College. But there's a national church there, Grace Baptist Church. And Ferez, we believe that's his first name. I'm not sure if they put first name or last name first, but the other name is N-A-I-K, F-E-R-E-O-Z-N-A-I-K. So however you want to say that, that's the pastor's name of Grace Baptist Church. And so he'll be going there. It's probably, I think, the... Right now, the flight, I think he said, is in the neighborhood of $1,300 to $1,500 round trip. So that's what we're aiming for, all right? And so give generously tonight, and that'll go towards making sure Brother Yoder travels there and gets to be a blessing to these churches and these pastors that'll be gathered together for a three-day pastors' conference there in India. All right, and let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for the privilege to give, and thank you, Lord, for opening up the door in India for Brother Yoder to travel there and, Lord, to minister to the church there and to the local pastors and the conference that he'll organize and some of the village church plants that he's established. And I pray, God, that you'd bless the offering tonight and it would go towards those travel expenses and be able to take care of the travel arrangements, Lord, and that you'll give him a very fruitful ministry there during this time. Bless the gift and giver tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, there we go. Take your Bibles, if you will, to Galatians chapter 5, please. Galatians chapter 5. Galatians 5, and look with me, if you will, at verse number 16. Galatians 5 and verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, Father, we pray that you will help us tonight as we open up your word and we begin to study it together. We need your understanding. We need the Holy Spirit to be our teacher. And I pray, God, that each of us would yield ourselves tonight to the Spirit of God, that he would be able to minister to each of us tonight in the room. And that, Lord, you'd help us to understand the flesh and how to get victory over the flesh. And so, Lord, help our study tonight and do here this evening what only you can do. And I'll thank you for it, for I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Going to begin a series here on Wednesday night, and we're going to get into some of the spiritual warfare and such, but this is kind of the introductory to that, and you'll see as we get into this and we deal with another enemy that we have before we get into dealing just with the devil. How many of you remember, how many old enough to remember a comedian on television that used to say, "The devil made me do it"? Huh? Yeah, that's right. Some even said his name, don't you? And Flip Wilson became popular using that as a character on his show, and people laughed. In fact, they made bumper stickers and other things that came out with that. And people's attempt to excuse their sin or excuse something they did wrong by laughing it off, by saying, "The devil made me do it." And, of course, I think Satan is very happy for us to laugh about him, or laugh about his power over our life, or his existence even in the world. And I think that he would like if we would just laugh him off, if we would just kind of make jokes about him. I don't think we ought to joke about Satan. I don't think we ought to joke about hell. Those are very serious matters, and they don't need to be joked about or be enter into that levity about those kind of things. We have to understand Satan, and we'll come to this in another week or so, but Satan is the enemy, and he is out to destroy the Christian. He has set himself against you, and if you haven't done battle with him yet, you will, and you're about to, because he is roaring about, walking about, seeking whom he may devour. Now, we're appreciative of Satan's power. Let me make sure, I'll just put in here, and we'll talk more about this in the weeks to come. Satan is not all powerful. Okay? Make sure you understand that. Only God is all powerful. And so now, Satan was a created being of God. Now, he may, as far as we see some scripture, he may be the most powerful of the created beings, but he is no match at all for God. Okay, he has to obey the authority of God. He still does. And so now let me say this: he is more powerful than you or I. Even in Jude, one of the other angels, Michael, when he was having a fight with the devil, he didn't even try to rebuke him or try to. He said, "The Lord rebuke thee." He even knew that he didn't have the ability to do that. And so we understand when we do battle against Satan, we don't do it in our power, for certainly we'll be defeated. But we have, in union with Jesus Christ and in the power of his word, we have the authority over the devil. We have the authority over Satan. Now, the emphasis in our warfare is not feelings, our emotions, or even some who have some real passion about the subject and passionate desires, so to speak. That's not weapons that we use to fight Satan. It's not an emotional battle. It's not even just a sincerity thing. You have to use the truth of the Word of God. You have to use the authority we have. The only way we're greater than Satan is, greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. Okay? That's the only way we have the ability. What Satan retreats from is authority. And we only have authority in Jesus Christ. He has the authority over Satan. So the defeat of our enemy depends on our reliance upon the Word of God and the person and the work of Jesus Christ. Now, the Bible makes it clear we have three enemies: the world, the flesh, and the devil. Okay? And tonight, I want to talk about our enemy of the flesh. We're going to get to fighting the devil, but I think you'll see how this ties into it if we don't first get victory over the flesh. I think it's important that we understand when the devil tempts us, it's outside pressure. That's what a temptation really is. An outside pressure to yield to some of our desires that are desires of the flesh. And so we have to be able to defeat the flesh. Now, there's several times in Scripture that God gives a list detailing the works of the flesh. And any time God gives a list of something in the Bible, you ought to pay attention to it. Okay? And I'm going to give you three different places, and we're going to focus on one of them tonight, but you do well to look all three up and just make a list. I encourage the folks in Reformers Unanimous to do this on Friday night and make a complete list up of all the works of the flesh. But it's in Mark 7, verses 21 through 23. Jesus spoke those words. Then you have Colossians 3 and verses 5 through 8. Another list. And then the list we're going to look at tonight is Galatians 5, verses 19 through 21. We're going to look at this list that Galatians 5 presents to us. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. And so here he begins to make the list of sins. At the very top of the list is, number one, adultery. Adultery. This is the thought or act of immorality after marriage. Adultery springs from a selfish, fleshly desire for physical gratification without spiritual responsibility. It's the flesh expressing its rebellion against God's law of purity, against God's law of the sacredness of marriage. It's rebellion against God's law. Marriage is honorable in all, the Lord said in Hebrews 13:4. And the bed undefiled. But adulterers and whoremongers, God will judge. Hebrews 13:4. So we see adultery. Then we move on to the next one, is fornication. That is the fleshly sin and the flesh expressing itself, the violation again of God's moral law of having sexual relations before marriage. Again, wanting to satisfy the sensual desires and gratify the flesh without any regard to what God says about it. Without any regard to what the Word of God says about it. Then the third one is uncleanness. Uncleanness, that's a wide range of moral sins. Evil, impure thoughts. So-called dirty stories or dirty books or dirty magazines. Pornography would come into this. Certainly unclean pictures or movies would be included. Again, this is where you're seeking to satisfy those sensual desires and gratify the fleshly desires in your thoughts and in your mind. And that goes against God's nature and against God's plan. That's never what God wants. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness. That's the stirring up of unlawful lusts. The stirring up of really it's the word is like animal passions, which cannot be fulfilled or cannot be satisfied within the limits of God's approval. You can be lascivious in the way you dress. You can be lascivious in the way you talk. You can be lascivious with your eyes or your smile or your physical gestures. You're stirring up lustful desires that will not righteously be fulfilled. That's lasciviousness. Then he follows that up with idolatry. Most of you know what idolatry is. That's the flesh where it is rebelling against worshiping God only. And it's not sometimes that I don't worship God, but I worship other things just as much as I do God. Anything on the same plane as God. And so that's idolatry. Now, idolatry can be something we place physically before God, or we can place it mentally before God. But we can put things before God. Pleasure, money, things things, work, even our family can become God. In other words, what it usually comes down to is this: we choose a God that pleases us rather than the God of the Bible. It's not just building something wood of stone and worshiping something and say, oh, I got an idol here. No, it's anything you place ahead of God. Anything that you put in the place that where God belongs, that's an idol. Then notice, so we have so far adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry. What's the next one, church? Witchcraft. What's that doing in there? This is a sin of the flesh, which comes from our desire to want to contact and relate to the mysterious spirit world. We desire to learn some of the mysteries of the unseen world in a manner other than what God has revealed in His Word. That would include all the occult things that go on, Ouija boards, tarot cards, seances, spiritism, levitation, astrology. They're all tools to take you to an area you don't want to go. We'll talk more about that in the weeks to come. In fact, it's interesting that the word translated witchcraft here is pharmakeia. We got our English word, pharmacy, from it. The use of drugs for sensational, mind-expanding experience. That's a form of witchcraft. Any kind of drug, experimentation and addiction, that's a fleshly sin that can easily lead to a bondage of Satan and really a stronghold for Satan in your life. The next one is hatred. Hatred. Again, what are we listing here? What is he detailing? The works of the flesh. Anybody in here not have any flesh? I got news for you. We all have flesh. Anything on this list, your flesh is capable of doing. Don't think your flesh can't do that. That's why, why would you be judgmental on somebody? Why would you look down on somebody? You know what? You got the same flesh they've got. Be careful. Hatred. Dark, ugly feelings of bitterness, contempt, loathing of another person. It's really a fleshly desire to establish my worth as an individual apart from God and His plan of salvation. You know why? You know why I'm worth something? Because God loves me. I'm a child of God. If I wasn't a child of God, I'd be worthless. My identity and my worth is who I am in Jesus Christ. And if you don't have that, then you try to find it some other way. And a lot of people find it by trying to put someone else down. By hating someone else, by putting someone else down, they think they lift themselves up, but they don't. Then he goes on to say, after hatred, variance. Variance is quarreling, arguing, being part of strife and discord. In fact, it's, and by the way, this is one of the seven things that the Lord hates, is someone who sows discord among the brethren. Someone who always wants to argue. You ever know anybody like that? I hope you're not like that. And we even say it. We even identify it without even thinking about it. You know what we say? Well, I just like to play the devil's advocate. Really? Is that what a Christian should do? Seems to me you get a different role model than that. You see, just to be argumentative, just to be able to fight. You know what that is? That's the flesh. That's the flesh wanting to do that. It's a fleshly desire for attention and a compulsion to prove that I'm right. And I'll even quarrel and argue with you to prove my point. Then he goes on to say, after variance, emulations. Say, what's emulation? Emulation is jealousy. That flesh expressing itself in inner feelings of resentment of what someone else is or what somebody else has or what we want. So we try to make ourselves better than somebody else because we want to achieve superiority. It really is about, it's just self-centeredness. Well, how come they got that and I didn't? Who are you focused on? Rejoicing with them that rejoice? Are you focusing on yourself? You're focusing on yourself. Self-centeredness. That's emulation. That's jealousy. A lack of thankfulness for what God has given to you. And being grateful for that. Then he goes on to say wrath. Wrath is a bad temper. It's violent anger. It's resentment. Again, this is where the flesh will strike out against anything that is threatening its self-interest. And so it'll lash out at somebody. Anger is the flesh's way of taking vengeance out of the hands of God and saying, I'll take care of it myself. I'm not going to wait for God to do something about this. I'm going to do something about this. That's anger or wrath. Then he says strife. Strife is self-seeking rivalry. I'm going to pull someone else down who in any way threatens me. It begins with verbal arguments and gets into maybe tenser conflicts, but eventually it could even get physical. And again, we forget the fact that God so loved the world. That he loves all of us and each of us and every one of us is a soul for whom Christ died. Why would I want to pull someone else down? And after strife, he says seditions. Seditions are, the word literally means to divide. To split in two parts. And I'm going to divide, and by the way, I'm going to divide because I'm going to try to find the group that will agree with me. That happens in churches. Churches divide and they split, and Satan gets a heyday. And by the way, when that happens, what's involved? The flesh. The flesh is involved. Quarreling among believers. Trying to get, and by the way, the example of this was the church at Corinth. I'm of Paul. I'm of Apollos. I'm of Cephas. Those are all preachers who they came to like. And then they had the other ones who said, oh, you guys are all carnal. I'm of Jesus. You see, and they're all trying to split the church over who their favorite preacher was. Sedition. And they were rebuked for that sharply by Paul. Jesus prayed. We looked at it John 17 on Sunday night. He was praying that they might be one even as we are one. That's unity. When God blessed the church there in Jerusalem in Pentecost and had the power of the Holy Spirit come down and 3,000 people saved and baptized. Hey, they were all with one accord and in one place. They had unity among one another. God honors that. Because when you go from seditions, you go to the next one, which is heresies. And this isn't so much as false doctrine heresy, but it's an unbiblical teaching where people begin to teach things that the Bible doesn't teach. And then want you to divide or be separate from people who don't believe that. And things that are not, they're not essential. I don't think, trying to think of something that would be a non-essential that people get upset about. You get that, yeah. And by the way, I remember reading about it. She said the color of the carpet in the church. I remember reading about a church that on the roof had half blue shingles and half red shingles because they were having a split over what color the shingles on the roof ought to be. And so half it's blue and half it's red. What a shame. What a shame for the community to see that. So be careful that you don't try to. The Bible says don't engage in foolish questions that gender strife. Don't engage in foolish questions of strife. Okay. I know several years ago we had a couple in the church and they didn't eat any pork. Okay? They feel like that was, the best. They don't do that. And you know what? That's fine. That's what they believe. Now, they didn't go around. If they would go around to everybody before service and say, hey, let me show you what the Bible says about why you shouldn't eat pork, then we'd have to have a talk. Because then they're trying to divide people on non-essential teaching, non-essential Bible teaching. All right? And listen, I'm not going to have them over to my house and have a ham dinner. Okay? Have them over the ham. We'll have something I know they can eat. We're not every time we get together and say, hey, let me show you some scripture I found about what you. Why would we just get together to argue? There's much more essential things that we agree on and we fellowship over and we focus on those things. We have extended family that have different beliefs in some areas in what we do, but not on essential things. And so what do? We fellowship on the essential things. We focus on what the things we should focus on. And so the heresies. Then he said envyings. Envyings. That's an inner discontent as we look upon another's success or superiority with a desire for his place. Someone else succeeds, someone else gets promoted, someone else gets blessed, and we secretly wish that was us. That's envyings. Again, that's really revealing a lack of inner security on our part, that God has taken care of us and that we're satisfied with what God's given to us. Then murders. The desire of the flesh to remove a life that stands in the way of some self-gratifying goal. Something I want that you're in the way of, and I'll just do away with you. I hard to understand what that violates, because God is the one who gives life and should take life. And when we take that into our hands, we're taking the place of God. Then he goes to drunkenness. Drunkenness is the flesh wanting to rely upon anything intoxicating, such as alcohol and drugs, to produce an artificial means of escape from facing our responsibilities and sometimes our sins. It's a fleshly behavior. It's a desire. It just makes us, the flesh says, just take this drink, drink this, drink these beers, take these pills, you'll feel better. That's what the flesh tells you. And the truth is, and again, we go back to this thing, and we'll talk about this later, but in the future, I mean, don't worry, it won't be tonight, but this idea that you're never supposed to be in pain. I'm going to tell you something. Sometimes the Holy Spirit has convicted me, and it hurt. And that pain was good for me to go through. And we get the idea, and they started that in the hospitals in 1994 is when that 1 to 10 scale came in. So somebody go in the hospital, and they say, what's your pain level on a scale of 1 to 10? And you go in there, and you say, it's 5 or 6 or 7. What's the next words they say? We're going to give you something for that pain. Don't want you to be in pain. All right. So I get out of the hospital. I'm home. And then things happen to me, and I'm in pain now. Maybe not physical pain, but emotional pain. Well, I'm not supposed to be in pain. What can I take so I don't feel this? And I don't think it's coincidence that we've seen such a rise in the last 20 years in drug use, prescription and non-prescription. They've fed that. And it's a lie of Satan. That's encapsulated here in this drunkenness. It's a temporary and artificial sense of well-being. But why would you want a temporary artificial sense of well-being when you're supposed to have the Holy Spirit of God, who is called the Comforter? Well, isn't He able to comfort us in all our afflictions and tribulations? Oh, I know, it's easier to pop a pill and forget about our troubles. Aren't you glad you came tonight? Oh, isn't this good? Then he says, revelings and such like. This is the revelings lead people into a kind of conduct where their sensual appetites dictate their behavior. It's where we just want to gratify the flesh, gratify the body, gratify the soul, what I want, what I think, what I feel, without any moral responsibility. Isn't that where we live? Isn't that where our country is? Galatians 5, verse 21. Notice what it says when it says, after revelings and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, they which do such things shall not, what church? Inherit the kingdom of God. Now it is not, let me make sure we understand this, it's not someone who ever did one of these things. This is they which do. That is the same continual sense as asking in prayer. Ask and ask and ask and keep on asking. Seek and seek and seek and keep on seeking. So they which do and keep on doing these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Don't look at that list and say, well, I think I've done some of those. Well, that's what the list is there for. It's for you to see you do it. But if you're practicing these things, if this characterizes your life, then, my friend, you need to be born again. Don't fool yourself into thinking, well, no, I said a prayer when I was 4 years old, or I was 6 years old, or I was 8 years old. My friend, if this characterizes your life, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. Not my words, His words. The wrongness of the sins of the flesh is obvious. Every one of these dishonors God. Do you understand how depraved we are? Do you understand just how wicked your flesh is? Do you think that I mean, is there any way we would say that, well, I think I'm good enough to go to heaven? Really? After seeing this list, and this is just one of the three. No wonder Paul said, I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. In Ephesians 4, in fact, look at Ephesians 4, would you? It's right after the book of Galatians. Just turn to your right, Ephesians 4. Here, he's talking about putting off and putting on. Again, putting off the old man, which is the flesh, and putting on the new man, the being yielded to the Spirit of God. And he sums it all up with verse number 27. When Ephesians 4:27, Paul said this, neither give place to the devil. Means that, listen, when I give place to the flesh, I don't put off the flesh and I give place to these fleshly sins. You know what I'm doing? I'm giving place to the devil in my life. It's an invitation for him to influence me and to be at work in my life. It literally means to claim ground. When I willfully, listen, as a Christian, when I willfully practice the deeds of the flesh, I'm inviting Satan to have a place. I'm giving him a piece of ground in my life. Now, you'll find out in the weeks to come that all the legal claim that Satan has to have any ground in our life was canceled at the cross. Jesus took care of that. But when I willfully indulge in the fleshly sins, it gives him an invitation to come, take up residence, and to get ground in my life. In fact, you're in Ephesians, keep going to your right there to 2 Timothy. Would you look there? In 2 Timothy, Paul is instructing Timothy here how to help people who have given into the lusts of the flesh, practicing fleshly sins. Says, and it starts in verse number 24, and the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, that they may recover themselves out of what? The snare of the devil, or taken captive by him at his will. I think it's just, again, fleshly living means we're allowing Satan to come into territory that he's not supposed to come into. But it's an open invitation for him to come into that territory when we engage in the sins of the flesh. And then from there, he'll establish a stronghold. Not just a foothold. He'll not just have a foot in the door. He'll exercise power over you. Now, he's not going to indwell a saved person. We'll talk the difference next week about possession and oppression and what the difference is. And sometimes, outwardly, you can't tell the difference. It'll look the same. But once that spiritual wickedness has gained a foothold in your life, it according to Ephesians 6, there's a whole hierarchy of power. Principalities, powers, rulers of darkness of this world, and you got all this hierarchy of power coming against you. That's why oftentimes people who get in that bondage and they're under demonic oppression, and certainly if they're under demonic possession, you know what they are? They're hopeless. They say, man, I'm just going to live this way the rest of my life. But there are Christians who are not quite there. They're not quite under the satanic oppression yet, but you know what they are? They're still struggling with the flesh. Don't be too quick to blame it all on Satan. Don't be so quick to say, well, the devil made me do it. It may just be that you don't have victory over the flesh. Now the question has to come, how do I overcome the flesh? How can I overcome these sins that are listed in Galatians 5? How can I do that? Well, look at Galatians 5, will you? And we'll get the prescription here for overcoming the sins of the flesh. And by the way, we ought to see that. And you ought to desire that in your life. Amen. Let's look at that in the last few minutes that we have. All right, we'll try to get this in. Step number one, Galatians 5. The first step, by the way, is just kind of all of it together. And I'll say this. Number one is honesty. Honesty. Why do you think, you ever stop and ask yourself, why did God three times, at least we know in Mark, and really Colossians and here in Ephesians is similar to Colossians, but why did God take the time to list these horrible sins, these works of the flesh? Why did he detail them and list them like that? If it wasn't the fact that we would see that and say, that's me. See, are you honest with yourself enough to say, that's me? I see myself there sometimes. And see, that's honesty. Honest with yourself and honest with God. Now, it's not that you don't look at some and say, I don't have a problem with that one. That's all right. You got a problem with the other one. And don't look at someone else and say, I don't have that problem. Yeah, but you got another problem that they may not struggle with. So, well, I don't have any impure thoughts. No, but you sure struggle with jealousy and anger. Strife. So be somewhere in that list, you see yourself, if you're honest. And that's what the Holy Spirit wants. He wants you to be honest. The very first thing you have to admit before you can be saved is you have to know that you are a sinner. If you won't see yourself as a sinner, why get saved? So you have to understand you're a sinner. So I think God wants us to admit how depraved we really are. How wicked that flesh really is. I'm not trying to, you look at that list and you look at the other list and say, well, let's see if we can reform this guy. Really? You're not going to reform the flesh. You're not going to be your project to make the flesh better. When that happens, people get frustrated. You know why? Because they keep seeing the same stuff come back. Not a very good reformer. So one of the first things you realize to see victory in the Christian life is to realize what a failure your flesh is. And how wicked your flesh is. And that you can't trust it at all. Don't hide from what you see here. Face it and admit it. God knows about our depravity. He knows about our sins. I think he wants us to realize it. And then we have to do the next step. Okay, now I know it. Now the second step towards victory. First step was what? Honesty. Second step is death. Death. Verse 24, Galatians 5. They that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. Romans 6:11, likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why success in spiritual warfare is achieved through objective fact, not subjective feelings. It's victory through what the Word of God says. It's faith based on absolute truth, not just vague wishes or emotional desires. We proceed against the flesh based on the truth of God's Word. The Bible says that Jesus Christ died on the cross, and when He died on the cross, we died with Him. I am crucified with Christ. We were buried with Him in baptism, Romans 6. See? We were dead, buried, and rose again with Him. What? That's the old man. That's the flesh. We only have ground in our heaven based on the fact we believe Jesus died, was buried, and rose again for me. And I trusted Him as my Savior. That's the basis we get into heaven's door and into the presence of God. But there's more than that that took place. He did that, and we're to identify with that because that gives us victory over the old nature. That gives us victory over the flesh. We got to put to death the flesh. We that are Christ have crucified the flesh. Romans 6. You got to look there. Romans 6. Are you all right? We're almost finished, believe it or not. I know you don't believe it. Romans 6. Oh, I wish we had all the time we wanted. Romans 6. Notice verse 6. Knowing this, that our old man, that's the flesh, is crucified with Him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over Him. For in that he died unto sin once, and that he liveth, he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon or account or appropriate yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof. Victory over the flesh is always an active, aggressive, day-to-day, sometimes moment-by-moment, of the appropriation of that truth. I'm reckoning myself to be dead indeed unto sin. Die to those outside pressures the devil brings, temptations, to appeal to the lusts of your flesh. Which you've heard me talk about it before. You know, we to show how powerful the flesh is. Everybody's here probably. Everybody here, be honest. Remember first step? Honesty. How many of you have been sleepy in church? Okay. And then once amen was said and service was over and you're outside, how many of them were wide awake? What was that all about? You'd be, man, I wish it was the other way around. Man, wide awake and alert and great in church, and then church is over, and you go, oh, man, I'm ready to go to bed. Because it seems like we're alive indeed under the flesh, but dead to God, and it ought to be the other way around. You need to appropriate that. So, we admit the fact, we're honest, that our flesh is depraved, it's wicked, there's no good thing in my flesh. So what good does it do for me to just try to do better? I can't do better. Flesh won't let me. So the only conclusion is, you got to die. Hey, flesh, you got to die. The things you've done, I've got to kill you. Crucify. The only thing to do with the old nature is to let it die. Kill it. Step number 3, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. death is not enough, but now we have to be alive unto God. The Spirit that raised up Jesus from the dead is the same Spirit that is able to raise us up and give us life. We're born again by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is what gives us life. That's how we become alive to the things of God. The Bible makes it clear that if all you ever do is die to the flesh and cast out even the man who cast out the demon, remember that guy? And all he did was clean himself up, but never put life in there, never put Christ in there. What happened to that guy? Seven demons came back. He was seven times worse than he was before. So it's not leaving a vacuum there. It's now I'm going to die to myself, I'm going to crucify the flesh, and I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to take over and to give me life. Romans 6 says, I'm dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Bible says that in Ephesians 5, we're to be filled with the Spirit. Filled with the Spirit is just to be controlled by the Spirit. I mean completely controlled by the Spirit. Not to be under the control of the flesh, but under the control of the Spirit. In other words, the Holy Spirit indwells every one of us. You have all of the Holy Spirit that you can possibly have the moment you get saved. But He does not necessarily have all of you. Doesn't control everything. You still have your control on some things. You still have some rooms of the house where the door's closed and locked and you have the key. You don't let them in there. The Bible says if you're going to get victory over the flesh, you have to let the Holy Spirit have complete control. You have to yield everything to Him. The filling of the Holy Spirit is appropriated by faith. I know you can read books, and I've read books, and you know the people who filled with the Spirit, and boy, they had this emotional or you know physical change that happened to them. They felt something, and they, you know, and the danger is you start seeking the experience instead of appropriating the fact. Take it by faith. Let me give you. Just going to list. I'm going to try to just list these six things and get you out of here. For obeying the command to be filled with the Spirit. How can I be filled with the Spirit? Number one, have an honest inner examination. Examine yourself. Again, honesty. And the reason you do that is, number two, you confess your all your known sin. I think verbalizing your transgressions is good. And by the way, if you're in sin, you've wronged somebody, you go to them and tell them you were wrong and that you ask their forgiveness. Again, that is part of taking back ground that Satan will hold on to. Number three, yield yourself to God. The Bible says in Romans 6, verse 13, that you neither yield you your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves to God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Have you ever consciously in the morning just said, Lord, I yield myself to you today? I yield my members as instruments of righteousness to you. Make it a conscious thing. Your business life, your entertainment life, your social life, your home life, your thought life, all of that yielded to God. Yielded to the Lord's authority and the Lord's control. Number four, express your desire for the Holy Spirit to fill you. The Bible said, Jesus said, I'll give the Holy Spirit to those who ask. Ask. If ye being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, shall not your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those that ask Him? You gotta know you want it. You gotta know you desire to be filled. Number five, then believe you are filled. Did He tell you to ask? Yes. Does He want you to be filled? You ask. Believe He filled you. You say, how do I know that? Take it by faith. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Take it by faith. Faith, not by feeling. Faith. Take God at His word. And then number six, continue to obey God's revealed will. And that's always found in the Bible. Obeying the Lord isn't mystical. It's not something you have to guess at and try to hope you're getting the right thing. No, that's what He gave us a Bible for. Do what the Bible says. Live the way the Bible says to live. The Holy Spirit is never going to lead you to disobey the word He inspired. He's never going to lead you to engage in an activity, to engage in behavior that's contrary to what the Word of God says. If ever that's the temptation, that's not the Spirit of God leading you. That's another spirit. Walk. Go back to Galatians and we'll be done. Galatians 5 again. Galatians 5. Notice verse number 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit. Walk, we learn, is take repeated steps in the same direction. So this I say then, take repeated steps in the same direction as the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. You got to have the leadership of the Holy Spirit of God. Honesty, death, filling of the Holy Spirit. You'll get victory over the flesh. You see, if you don't, you continue to indulge the flesh, you're inviting Satan to come along and to have an entrance. That's why after we do this, Romans 6, did you catch what verse 12 said? It said, let not sin. Therefore, if sin is reigning in your body, if some sins captured you, it is because you have let it. And when you let it, that's inviting, as a believer, you're inviting demonic oppression to come and to exercise authority over you when it doesn't have any authority over you. But you're allowing it to have that authority. And we'll talk some about how you can get victory on that when we get together next week. Okay? Thanks for listening. You're good listeners. Let's stand together for prayer, shall we? Father, thank You for this evening. Thank You, Lord, for the attention of everyone tonight. And Father, this is such an important, important subject. A lot of ground we covered here this evening. But Lord, I pray if anybody remember anything, we'd be honest with ourselves and say, boy, I see that this flesh is never to be trusted. This flesh is wicked and depraved and against God. It doesn't understand the things of God. It does not desire the things of God. I'm honest about that. And so God, help us to crucify the flesh with the affections and lusts. Help us to appropriate that death that Jesus died. We were dying too. We were being crucified as well. Buried and rose again by Your Spirit. We were born again into the family of God. And Father, I pray that we'd be filled with the Spirit. We would we would live lives of obedience to you. And we would walk daily in the Spirit and not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. Give us that victory, Lord. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'm just going to ask for a raise of hands tonight before I close in prayer. But I wonder this evening how many folks would say, Pastor, that truth helped me tonight. I needed that to get victory over my flesh. Pastor, pray for me this evening, will you? Slip your hand up, Christian, will you? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. You may put them down. Father, thank you for dealing with our hearts tonight. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. Now, Father, I pray we'll leave this place walking in the Spirit, yielded to you, yielding our members as instruments of righteousness unto God. We love you. Thank you for a wonderful night together tonight. Dismiss us now and make us mindful that you go with us from this place. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's sing Higher Ground. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. By faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. One thing, Brother James pointing to chairs. I got a phone call today from our carpet installer. He was in an accident yesterday. Sprained his wrist really bad. And the doctor has told him to take 3 days off. So he said he needs to reschedule and come Monday again. So he promised me, he said, I'll have plenty of guys there, Pastor. He said Tuesday evening it'll be done. So it'll start Monday morning bright and early. They'll have it done Tuesday night. So we have to shift gears, and we'll clear everything out Sunday night, okay? And then anybody who's available Wednesday anytime to come in and get it set back up for Wednesday night, we'll have new carpeting by Wednesday evening, okay? So pray for his wrist to heal up, will you? And I'm thankful that's all it was. Amen. Nothing worse than that. So thank the Lord for that. But that's the change of plans. Thank you for reminding me to say something about that, James. All right, you are dismissed.